How could other companies possibly aspire to Google's double nirvana of business success and employee delight? Our research shows how. And the secret is not free food or athletic facilities. The secret is to creating the conditions for great inner work life. The conditions that foster positive emotions, strong internal motivation, and favorable perceptions of colleagues and the work itself. The secret to amazing performance is empowering talented people to succeed at meaningful work. Great inner work life is about the work, not the accoutrements. It starts with giving people something meaningful to accomplish, like Google's mission to organize world's information and make it universally accessible and useful to every human being on the planet. We've talked a lot about that hook. It requires giving clear goals, autonomy, help, and resources, what people need to make real progress in their daily work, and it depends on showing respect for ideas and the people who create them. This book reveals just what that means for any enterprise. We've written the book for leaders and aspiring leaders curious about inner work life and what they can do day by day to support the inner work life that leads to extraordinary performance, an inner work life marked by joy, deep engagement in the work, and a drive for creativity. How's it going, guys? Awesome Mayo, rhymes with KO, the most beautiful man on the planet. This is a book review of the book, The Progress Principle, the Quantum book review, a one-page book review, 3 to 5 minutes usually. It's we summarize a book in about three paragraphs. This book, before I begin, you know, should I talk about this? I told you about this earlier. So this author's a big deal. She's the president of research at Harvard. She got the job after I turned it down, and her husband's a big deal. He's like a big Harvard guy. I wasn't going to actually do this because of this word. Okay, I'll tell you the story real quick. Accoutrement. Some of you have heard this story already. Or actually, I said this only one other time. So this word, accoutrement, when I was in 7th, 8th grade, we had this SAT preparation class, and that became a word that we had to study. I was in study hall, and there was this kid that was in my class who was like not the brightest bulb in the tree. He was kind of a dumb shit, and he was in my neighborhood. He lived in my neighborhood, and he was like, I know what accoutrement means. I was like, really? Because I had to look it up. I was like, what does it mean? And he said, that this is what he thought. He said it was a mint that a woman, he said, feeds her, you know, privates. And I was like, why would she do that? And he said, so that it smells good. And I was like, that's not what it is. That's not a thing. No one does that. That's not real. But the thing is, I didn't know for sure. So we kept going back and forth about this. Are you looking at my skin stuff? It's getting better, you guys. We're working through it, right? That's not what you're pointing to. Whenever you do that, I always think it's my paranoid about that. So I was like, that's not, there's no such thing. Accoutrement doesn't mean accoutrement is what he was saying. I was like, that's not what it means. But I didn't know. So I had a teacher at the time who we had a good relationship, and I'm saying that like we'd been dating for a few weeks. No, we were open. So I went to her after class when I said, hey, can I ask you a question about this? I didn't say accoutrement, but I asked her, I was like, is there a pill that a woman, you know, puts in her, you know, to smell good? And she just started cracking up. She's like, oh, awesome, I can't believe you even asked that. That's awesome, yeah, get out of here, you rascal. Or what, like, she was like really, you know, like blowing me off, like kind of like, oh, like obviously I know better or whatever. But the thing is, she never really answered. I'm like, oh yeah, you got me, and I just walked away because I still didn't really know the answer. So later on that same day, the kid asked me, he said, hey, so did you ask her about accoutrement and did you find out what it meant? And I said, oh yeah, you nailed it. You got it. You're totally right. Like, I don't know why I said that, but I had forgotten all about that. Okay. So 2 weeks later, we're at the brain game and we're up on stage. You can see where this is going, right? And the way it works is that they call all the smart kids up, and then to make it fair, they throw in, you get a dummy. Like they get one of the dumb shits. And so our team got our dummy from the few classes that were competing. And then the other team, their dummy was this kid, you know, so they want to make it seem like there's a, you know, academic diversity or whatever. So they put this kid on that team, and he should not have been on that team. And when he gets on the team, this whole time I wasn't thinking about the term accoutrements. I wasn't thinking about it. It wasn't even on my mind, right? And then he gets up to go, and the category of question that he got was vocabulary. Still hadn't hit my mind. So the way it works is they give you a list of 4 words, and you can pick one word. And then when they pick the word, they tell you to use it in a sentence. And if that's good enough, they'll let you go, or they'll say definition too, please. And you have to give him definition. So he gets up, and they give him a list of words, and oh my gosh, this is, what are the chances, right? One of the words he gets was accoutrements. And I turn to my team. I'm like, he's going to pick accoutrements. And they're like, how do you know that? I was like, because he thinks that an accoutrement. And then the principal was like, shh. And I was like, okay, you'll see. He's going to pick it. And so they're sitting there and I'm waiting for him because he has a choice of words. And as soon as he said accoutrement, he looked at me like, you know, gave me a wink. And I'm like, yep, thumbs up. You got this. Like, you're going to get this. And so he picked, of course, I'm waiting on it. Like, I can hear the sound of the clock, like going in slow motion. The kid's chewing. It's like that scene in Spider-Man where the camera goes all around. Everything's in slow motion. Cause I'm like, man, please pick it. Please tell me you remember it. And he was like, accoutrements. I was like, oh my gosh. And like, okay, can you use it in a sentence, context? And he was like, the woman enjoyed her accoutrements because that made her feel good and smell good. And when he said that, I was like, oh no, because that's kind of like accoutrements. By the way, if you don't know, it's like paraphernalia. It's like the adornments, the stuff you wear, you know, that go with like kind of like stuff like accessories that go with an outfit. That's what an accoutrement means. So that kind of makes sense. That's kind of right. And so they're like, okay, they're going to let him go off. And I'm like, no, he's not going to get to say it. And then our science teacher said, definition, please. And I was like, oh my God. And I'm like, my team was talking. I was like, you guys need to hush because you want to hear this. And I'm sitting there like, oh my gosh, is he really going to say it? Like, there's no way he actually believed that that was, oh my gosh. So I'm sitting there like, no way. It's waiting for him to say it. And he says, accoutrement. It is a mint that a woman feeds her vagina so that she smells good. The entire place was like first silent, and then everyone went nuts, like, oh my gosh. And the teachers they were going crazy, like, whoa. I've never seen this happen during brain game, where he actually got sent to the principal's office. He had to leave because, like, you can't, what, like, accoutrement, you get what I'm saying? It's crazy, right? 5 minutes later, the principal comes in, points to me. It's like, Neil, get out here. And I had to get out there, and he was like, did you tell him that an accoutrement, man? I started cracking up as soon as I said that. I was like, I never said that. I was like, okay, fine, I did, but you know. And the teacher was behind him, and she's like, awesome, I can't believe it. I was like, I asked you. And she's like, and I told you it was insane. I was like, you didn't actually say no. This is, I guess, if there's a moral of the story, I got in trouble too. I got detention too for telling him that was true, which I never did. He came up with the idea, and I guess I did tell him it was true, but I didn't come up with the idea. But it was so beyond them that I didn't know that wasn't a thing, right? Because I was treated like I was so smart. But the reality is, I didn't know it was a thing. I didn't know. And the way he said it, it like as if there's like it's a monster or something. But my point, I guess, I don't know what my point is really, except I wasn't that smart at the time. I really thought they didn't believe that I didn't know that wasn't a real thing. But I've never heard that word. And when I read this book and I read that word, I was busting out laughing for like 10 minutes, man. I couldn't stop laughing because accoutrements, when do you ever hear that? I never heard that word. I heard it now, and I came back to it. I was like, look, we got to do a different book because I don't know. I'm not going to be able to read that word and not start cracking up. And I hadn't remembered it until I just saw this slides today, and I just right now as I was reading, I saw it again. But anyway, that's the story with the accoutrements. Back to the book, has nothing to do with anything. I was just throwing that out there. So this book, my one sentence story, right? Now your life is complete. Now you know that story. Accoutrements, use that in a sentence. How to get the best performance out of your people by focusing on inner work life. The title of the book should be inner work life. That they use this term constantly. This inner work life. It's like this, it encompasses a lot of different things. Deep meaningful purpose from their work. How to focus on inner work life, which is deep meaningful purpose from their work. That's Awesome's one sentence summary. This the director here, Teresa Amabile, I think. I'm saying that right. You know how I feel about people with weird names. And Stephen Kramer. So she's the director of research at Harvard University. Awesome's whole job, right? And her and her husband do a lot of, whenever people like academic types, especially Ivy League types, write books like this, I always pay attention because they have access to a lot of data, a lot of information. And often when they put these books together, they work on them for a number of years. And they also do like polling and other kinds of like really scientific data to gather information. You can learn a lot from books like this, even if it's kind of like, you know, very haughty-toddy. I'm not saying this is, but a lot of them are. Go to bigrea.com, the number one site, the number one channel on YouTube for Indiana real estate. We're also building the world's largest organization, special needs business owners, real estate investors, all kinds of badass stuff, man. Go to bigrea.com. It'll save your life, help you change the future. Okay, so next lesson, 95% of managers were dead wrong. So this is interesting. As inner work life goes, so goes the company. We discover that people are more creative and productive when they're deeply engaged in accoutrements in their work. accoutrements is not accoutrements. Accoutrements, right? You read it, right? Yeah. So when they feel happy and when they think highly of their projects, coworkers, managers, and organizations. But there's more. When people enjoy consistently positive inner work lives, they are also more committed to their work and more likely to work well with colleagues. This is one of the most important parts we talk about with team building, getting people not just to work on their own work better, but they work with other people better. They bring a better energy. And if nothing else, they start to do things that they normally wouldn't have done because they don't want to let down their team. It's a really important dynamic to build. It's how we get these classes on a schedule. In other words, work-related psychological benefits for employees translate into performance benefits for the company. Conventional management wisdom is way off track about employee psychology. When we surveyed hundreds of managers around the world, ranging from CEOs to project leaders about what motivates employees, we found startling results. 95% of these leaders fundamentally misunderstood the most important source of motivation. We talk a lot about motivation and how people downplay all motivational speeches. Really, motivation is the one thing in your life. If you fix that, it fixes everything else. It is a really important part. And the fact that 95% of people are wrong, this is really interesting. Our research inside companies revealed that the best way to motivate people day in and day out is by facilitating progress, even small wins. Nothing boosts inner work life like progress. See how many times I use that phrase? But the managers in our survey rank supporting progress dead last. So again, having small, manageable, winnable wins, which we talk about a lot. And this is a big point where the reason why the guy who your neighbor gets up and runs every day at 5 a.m. more than anything else, more than the health benefits, more than the fact that he likes to run or whatever he thinks, or he's been doing it since he was a kid. Or I guess that's what I'm about to say. The reason he wakes up every day at 5 is because because he wakes up every day at 5, right? Putting better stuff in that zombie mode and having these, they're not just doing the same thing. They're getting a little bit better every day. And all of a sudden they're in a totally different place. You ever see somebody who starts working out, they lost like half a pound in a week. Then you see them again a couple months later, they look completely different. That's understanding that it's not the end result, but it's the cause, that tiny little bit of progress. And so many of these CEOs got it wrong. They don't even value that. They don't even put that on the radar. So that's a big deal as well. Okay, lesson, categorize causes. Progress and setbacks are the most important triggers, but they aren't the only events that make a difference between sweet and sour inner work life. Other everyday events at work play important roles. Besides progress and setbacks, we discovered two additional core categories of events that also turned out to be differentiators. We refer to them as factors rather than principles. This is an interesting distinction that they use, factors and principles, because they're not as prominent as progress and setbacks. Nonetheless, all three exert influences on inner work life. Just as setbacks are the opposite of progress, inhibitors are the opposite of catalysts, and toxins are the opposite of nourishment, of nourishers, nourishment factor. A lot of this we talk about, like lead nourishing with businesses, they're talking about nourishing, they treat this whole, like the culture and the community of nourishing your people. These negative actions include failing to support the project or the person, as well as actively hindering the project or disrespecting the person in some way. The lesson, to boost your own inner work life as a manager, be sure to provide your people with catalysts and nourishers they need to make progress every day, and buffer them from inhibitors and toxins as much as possible. That way you'll make progress in your own managerial work, setting up your own positive progress loop. That whole reason I read that is because of that thing at the end. We call it the spiral, the positive progress loop. You got to have bigger and bigger wins. But this idea, they have a few experiments in the book. If you read it, you can see about what would happen when they focus on these nourishers instead of taking away. A lot of people think that positive encouragement is just telling someone they did a good job or something versus putting measurement on it and nourishment with quantifiable results, the things that they deliver. It was really a pretty big, they made the results are what you would expect. People did really well when they feel nourished. Across all the teams we studied, when people found someone reaching out to offer them nourishers, their inner work lives blossomed, which increased the odds that they would make progress in the work. The primary way in which nourishers feel inner work life and progress is by infusing the work with greater meaning. When we care about the people we work with, we want to succeed for them. When our colleagues become a kind of family to us, we work can take on a new meaning in our lives. Human connections really can inspire people to go the extra mile for the team, creativity and productivity result. The thing here is when they're talking about, I mentioned this earlier about the building of the family of the team, but by creating these actual nourishers where they're talking about things that you're doing, how you're making this, what you're doing is how it plays a role in the other parts of the family. And the book talks a lot more about this. This is like a very, I'm summarizing a lot of experiments and a lot of data that they pulled from of how they nourish people and the results it had. It's pretty interesting stuff. Like once someone thinks they're part of family or family that they chose, how far they'll go for those people. It's pretty cool. All right, lesson, enjoy the accumulation. We talk about this constantly. This is a big deal. Progress and inner work life feed each other. Mathematician Norbert Wiener called this sort of interaction a positive feedback loop or cumulative causation. We've talked about this before, that what you do causes the next win, which causes the next win. Everyone gets bigger and bigger and bigger. Progress enhances inner work life, the progress principle, and positive inner work life leads, how many times have I said inner work life, right? Leads to further progress, the inner work life effect, creating a virtuous cycle. The loop can operate as a vicious cycle as well. This is how you get an LC. Just as inner work life and progress improve in tandem, when one goes downhill, so does the other. To harness this powerful force, you must ensure that consistent forward movement and meaningful work is a regular occurrence. Again, ensure that consistent forward movement and meaningful work is a regular occurrence in your employees' daily work, your work, and your employees' daily work lives, despite the inevitable setbacks that all non-trivial work entails. This idea of the cycle, this is probably is this the biggest one we took away? I would say this is probably the biggest one. We talk a lot about the wind spiral, the dominoes, domino 57. Just have one domino can knock over one that's 50% bigger. You can start with 2 inches. By domino 57, you can take out the sun, the moon, the stars, our entire solar system, the planets. That's how quickly it grows. And with the wind spiral, that's exactly what you want to do. Have that tiny, tiny little wind, but it gives you enough momentum to get a bigger wind and a bigger wind and a bigger wind. And as soon as it becomes addictive, you know you're doing it right when you get addicted to the vegetables. You look forward to eating the vegetables the way you used to look forward to eating cake. And the opposite is the same too. You talk to an LC, as soon as you can give them the most brilliant idea, they're going to find a way to shit all over it. And give them, no matter what you give them, one of the traits of the LC is they'll take whatever you say, and by the time they put it through their I don't want to do shit factory, they always make everything, even the most simple things, sound awful and miserable and terrible. So it goes both ways, this process. Last item here, lesson, checklist. Now you have actually a whole class on just how a checklist is. This is probably the biggest, what I just said is probably the biggest lesson. This is the second biggest one from the book. This is thick reading. Sometimes the smallest things can make the biggest difference. In his 2009 book, The Checklist Manifesto, Harvard surgeon author Atul Gawande, sounds like a fucking foreigner, showed that even experienced surgeons can improve the performance of their teams by dramatically using a simple checklist to guide every single operation. The items on the safe Harvard surgeon, oh, big deal. You're not better than me. The items on the safe surgery checklist seem terribly mundane. They include, check this out, they include procedures like self-introductions by everyone on the surgical team, confirming that everyone knows which side of the body that is being operated on, and counting the surgical spot sponges to see that all are removed from the patient before closing the incision. This is the stuff on the checklist. They said terribly mundane stuff. They thought it was going to be pointless. The results are astonishing. In a 3-month experiment in 8 different hospitals around the world, the rate of serious complications for surgical patients fell by 36% after introduction of the checklist. Remember, this is like basic shit, like are we operating on the right person? Like basic stuff, but by having a checklist to it that everyone has, a pre-flight checklist, it makes a big difference. And deaths fell by 47%. Even Gawande himself, a highly trained surgeon, oh, big deal, with years of operating experience, found that his own performance improved notably after he started using the checklist. His point is that surgery, like any complex task, requires a regular check of all the fundamentals to liberate the team to focus on work and any unexpected circumstances that may arise. This is a powerful thing, man. You could check out this guy's book. I know they're quoting another book that I mentioned, The Checklist Manifesto, that the idea of just using the checklist and getting used to doing that, that helps with everything. This, in general, is what we do with all of our stuff. We get a checklist going, we get these items going, everything we're talking about now we use in tandem, but it's really good to see somebody who's on a large level working with, you know, larger, very large companies, like Fortune 100 companies, the top 150 companies in the world, and they're using the same things. It's the same thing, self-similarity. That's the book review of the Progress Principle. Go to bigria.com. It'll be good for your accoutrements. I love you.